Tom Libous reports to you. Fighting to keep state spending under control. Exploring new options for economic growth and jobs for our communities. Helping our kids succeed by encouraging them to read and stay away from drugs and alcohol. Hi, you're watching Tom Libous Reports to You. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, the Senator and I are going to talk about the budget agreement. How are you, Senator?
I'm good. How'd you like the new opening on the show?
I like it.
Did you like the voice? That's yours, isn't it?
That is my voice.
Very nice. Very nice.
So let's get down to business.
A lot of business to talk about.
There's an agreement to the budget.
Agreement on the budget. That's great news.
Yeah, and it stays true to your commitment where reducing spending, cutting taxes, and giving businesses a tool to create jobs.
Well, you know, we worked very hard with the governor and certainly came to a good budget, one that is doing all those things. We're going to reduce a deficit of about $10 billion. We started the year with a structural deficit that is a real problem for all of you taxpayers. And we said that we were not going to increase taxes, and we didn't. There are no new taxes in this budget. There is no new borrowing in this budget. And I'm very proud to say there are no new member items or earmarks in this budget. So we kept our word to you. We kept our word to everyone throughout the state when we said in the Senate that we wanted to work with Governor Cuomo, come up with a sound budget, a sound fiscal plan that would put the state back on track, and we believe it will.
Yeah, and you were really listening to your constituents. You set up a hotline, a budget hotline, to get feedback from them, and we have a few of those calls. So let's go to the first one right now. It's John from Binghamton.
Sure.
All right.
Sure.
Tom, I support your efforts to cut state spending. As 27-year employee of the state of New York, I firsthand know of the wasted spending of taxpayers' money. Keep up the good fight, Tom, and don't let them push you around. Be tough against the unions. We'll take care of take the New York State back to where it was in grand times.
So what kind of message were you trying to send by passing a budget without taxes?
Passing a budget without taxes is sending a positive message about job growth. This state has overtaxed. I think somebody said just the other day that, you know, we have the highest per capita tax of any state in the country. We want to reduce that. What we want to do is make sure that taxes don't go up, and they're not going up in this budget. We want to help create jobs. We want to give companies an opportunity to come here. You know, there's been a lot of talk, Julia. We've had certainly, you know, teachers union representatives complaining about the budget. We've had a number of different folks who were concerned, but overwhelmingly, people in my district, and we've got the calls on the hotlines. We got thousands of on TomLibous.com. Thousands of people went on TomLibous.com, and they basically said, "Tom, we are tired of the taxes in New York. We are tired of the spending. Do it differently," and that's what we did here. We work with Governor Cuomo. We're doing it differently. No new member items, no new taxes, no new borrowing. We're going to close a $10 billion deficit. It's something that the state has not done before.
Recharge New York, it's the new Power for Jobs program that'll help businesses stay in operation, create jobs, and retain jobs. Tell us about that.
Recharge New York, we've talked about in this program, it's the old Power for Jobs. It helps a lot of companies in the southern tier. It gives them a better rate on the amount of power that they use. Many of these companies couldn't afford to do business here because states like Pennsylvania have Penelec power, which is megawatts cheaper than what we can get in New York State. Sometimes it's pennies, sometimes it's nickels and dimes cheaper, but that adds up to an awful lot of money. We had to do something. The assembly kept holding this up. The governor helped push this through. I worked very hard to get this done. We got it in the budget. We convinced Mr. Silver, Speaker of the Assembly, it's time to do this. We're losing jobs. So another big victory. Power for Jobs is going to become law. It's not going to have to be extended every 6 months or a year. It's a good energy program that helps business. It's going to help upstate New York.
All right, let's take another caller from your budget hotline. This person wants the state to take an opportunity to develop lower cost power right in your district.
Good morning, Tom. I agree that we need to cut the budget, quit spending. I'm 74 years old, and I lived all my life within my budget and done well that way, and the state needs to do the same thing. And of course, I know you agree with this one. We got millions of dollars sitting right underneath us. We let it go to Pennsylvania, and they drill for gas. We can do away with our budget with bringing gas out of the ground. But I have never in my life seen politicians with such short, limited views. They couldn't run a chicken farm and make it right. Sounds a little forceful, but that's how I feel. Thank you.
Well, I think it probably is very difficult to run a chicken farm today, but to listen to that caller, certainly I thank him for calling in. Look, people want lower taxes. They want less government, and that's what we're trying to do here. For the first time, this government is paying attention. I am paying attention as a new member of the Republican Senate, one who is the deputy leader who has something to say about crafting a new direction for the state, working with Senator Skelos, our leader, working with certainly Governor Cuomo. There are a number of things we can do. This caller and others, they've had it, Julia. They're fed up, and they're now pleased that we're taking the bold initiative to make change, and that's what people want.
Right. This budget spends less than last year's budget, and there's also a plan to reduce year-to-year spending to put us on a path of fiscal.
Yeah, we do reduce year-to-year spending, particularly in Medicaid and in school aid. And what it does is it's a two-year plan, something that we have not done before or not done effectively. I think we've tried to do two-year plans. And what this is going to do is hold the rate of growth down so that if we were to spend at the same rate, next year's budget, we would show a $15 billion deficit. Because of the way we've set up and structured this budget, the deficit will only be in the neighborhood of about $2 billion. That's a big difference. You're saving $13 billion. $2 billion, I know this sounds wild, but it's manageable. In a $132 billion budget, it's very manageable. So we've already put things into place that are going to help reduce the rate of spending in next year's budget. So that's solid. That's something that hasn't been done. At the same time, you know, we're reorganizing. We're looking at mandate relief. Our work is not done just because the budget's going to pass.
Right. So there's talk of an on-time budget or maybe even an early budget. Do you think that has the new leadership, the Senate taking back, the Republicans taking back the Senate and the new governor, do you think that has any?
It has everything to do with it. Senator Skelos and I were committed from the time we took over the conference to work with Governor Cuomo to get a budget done on time. One of the most important things people are looking for is an on-time budget. It sends a message. You know, school districts need an on-time budget. Local governments need an on-time budget. Businesses want to hear that the state did its business on time. Taxpayers, the people that are watching this program, they have to pay their taxes by April 15th. If they don't pay their taxes by April 15th, the state goes after them with consequences. There's no reason why the legislature shouldn't have a budget on time. We're going to have a budget done on time this year. You know, they say early. I'm not going there. All I'm telling you is that my goal is to get a budget done before April 1st, not on April 1st, but before April 1st. That's going to send a very, very positive message.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
When it comes to health care, you know, we've talked on this program before about the need for Medicaid reform, but you've also advocated for older New Yorkers to be able to afford the prescription drugs they need.
We went to bat for our elderly New Yorkers who are in the EPIC program. The governor did cut the EPIC program, and we were able to restore money to that program. We heard loud and clear from groups, seniors. I deal with a lot of seniors in my district. We talk about various things that are important to them. I can tell you one out of two says to me, I love that EPIC program. The other thing they love is the Star Property Rebate Program or the Star Property Tax Program. They like the rebate checks before when we used to give them to them, and hopefully we can start that up again. But that's probably the two issues that seniors talk to me about, EPIC and Star. Well, Star's going to be in place. Nothing's going to change there, so that's good. But EPIC, the governor did cut the EPIC program. We have put money back into the EPIC program to kind of restore what he took away from it.
And you're also putting Medicaid in check.
We are putting Medicaid in check. We're not letting the waste and abuse of Medicaid continue. Billions of dollars in waste. We've seen this time and time again. I mentioned earlier that, you know, by doing Medicaid over a two-year period, we believe that there's significant savings. We believe that, you know, there's ways to go after the waste and fraud. The Senate Republicans, our conference, a year and a half ago, came out with a very extensive and exclusive report that talked about Medicaid fraud. I'm going to dust that report off in a couple of months and come back out, because what happens around here, Julia, once the budget's done, people seem to think, well, okay, it's over with. No, we need to start preparing for our savings for next year. We need to make sure that the good programs, the implementation of going after fraud and cheats in the Medicaid program, in the welfare program, those kinds of things, you know, they have to be ongoing. We have to keep that constant. So that's important.
Yeah, it's really about reinventing government.
It's about reinventing government. It's about reforming government. You know, the word reform is tossed around a little bit too much. We are actually reinventing government. We are changing the way we've done business. Just think about it. 1983 was the last time a budget was done on time, even long before I came to the legislature. So see, all the late budgets weren't my fault. it was a pattern that started years before I came to the legislature. This is going to be done on time. This is going to send a positive message. This is telling the folks that are watching this program and all over New York State, you know, some of us politicians heard you loud and clear. We listened, and we're in the process of making change. And we have a governor who's a partner in helping us make that change. I've said this time and time again. You know, the governor and I will differ on social issues. So there's a lot of issues he and I are not going to agree on. But we do agree on creating jobs, reducing the tax burden, shrinking the size of government, no new borrowing, and on those things, I'm very proud to stand with him, shake his hand, and move forward to get these items done for the people of New York State.
You were able to restore some cuts to public schools and some teaching hospitals.
Yes, we did. You know, the upstate teaching hospitals were cut again by the governor. We believe as an upstater that those hospitals are critically important. We know that they do some work with Binghamton University, and we continue to talk with them to do additional work. So there's a partnership there. That's very important. School aid. Very interesting point that I want to make. You know, we tend to get the wrath of those education people who believe in more money. We get it in the Senate, but yet it's the Assembly that only put $200 million back from what the governor cut. We put over $280 million, and eventually I think we've come to about $270 million. So it's the Senate year in and year out that cares about our kids, that cares about the future of our schools. But having said that, it's not going to be as great as it has been in the past. Our schools are going to have to use the reserve funds. Many of them have reserve funds. Why do you have a reserve fund? Why do you have a savings account? You have it for a rainy day or a bad time. This indeed is a bad time. This is a very bad rainy day. So we would encourage that while we did restore some money, that the school districts that have reserve funds use them. You know, if you can prevent layoffs by using your reserve funds, I would highly recommend that you use them.
Right. You had some pushback to the school cuts. This next caller to your budget hotline really addresses the issue of special interests.
Tom, my name is Catherine, and I agree with you completely. These lobbyists have got to be stopped, and I think the unions have got to learn to compromise. Thank you for doing such a wonderful job, and I have a lot of faith in you.
You know, a lot of folks out there, a lot of people feel very emotionally about this. Certainly, you know, I'm not afraid to work with labor. I've had a good relationship with labor, but there are also a lot of people that feel that everybody has to sacrifice.
Right, absolutely. Thank you so much for being with us. For any additional information, you can log on to the Senator's website, tomlibous.com.